Okay, dear viewers, this program is coming to you from the Chronicle in the Gambia. My name is Sheriff Bojang Jr., and today we'll be discussing about some of the pertinent issues in the country. We have distinguished gentlemen here, diverse field of work, all Gambians, people who risk it all, people who were voices for Gambia during times of dictatorship, during hardship. They've seen it through, and December 2016, to the polls, dictatorship eclipsed into history and gave way to what we thought was a government that would respect democracy, freedom of speech, free flow of information, and would give Gambians what they voted for. Almost 3 years down the line, what happens in the Gambia? Today we'll be discussing some of these issues, and we will be defining democracy and good governance in the Gambian context from the views and opinions of these distinguished Gambians, distinguished gentlemen. Dr. Cissé, Ismaila Cissé, you're the guest of this gentleman here today. So when Gambia went to the polls, and Jammeh was voted out, Adama Barrow came in right after people celebrated what they thought was democratic gains. 3 years, almost 3 years down the line, Barrow, the president, and his inner circle celebrate what they said was success in moving the Gambia from dictatorship, where people were afraid to speak, to today, where everybody is free to speak. But some say no. It's democracy in reverse. Where are we as far as democracy is concerned in this country?
Thank you very much, Sheriff. There's a new trend that they call democratic backsliding, and that it seems like that is what we are experiencing in the Gambia. Obviously, like you said, under Jammeh's regime, there was despondence in this country. People had lost hope. People had lost hope for the future. People thought that it was done. Nothing can be done about this country. Then came 2016. That was a glimmer of hope. There were high expectations. But for me, what scares me most is the rate at which these expectations have subsided, and that's very dangerous. It happens so quickly. I mean, if it happens gradually, when people, expectations are not met gradually, that's much better. But for me, the rate at which people have really lost hope in this new government, in this new dispensation, it's very dangerous. So what we are seeing now, yes, people are free to speak, but what are we saying? Are we saying productive things? Are we having a national debate that is aimed at moving this country? Objective, mature, balanced manner that can really make this country move. It seems like most of the debate that we are having, yes, people are talking freely, but what most of the things that we are saying are basically mostly destructive. That are based on sentiments. We don't discuss ideas. We attack each other. There are tribal sentiments here and there. Obviously, yes, freedom, but at what cost? So for me, I think we should bring back a civilized, mature, objective national discourse to discuss the problems of this country. We have very many problems in this country. And I think it's high time for us to sit and interrogate those problems and start to find solutions to those problems.
The issue of interrogating the problems, Coach, as far as you are concerned, where lies the problem?
Well, with the government, when we went to the polls, our objective was to have a new beginning, unfettered respect for fundamental human and constitutional rights. What we have gotten, in essence, is a government that is more interested in entrenching in itself than addressing the basic needs and aspirations of the Gambian people. And we now have a government that is pretty much backsliding, like he said, towards Jammeh. What do I mean by that? Any government that is working day and night to try to protect itself from its citizens is a government that is sliding towards tyranny. Because if anything that everything And anything that Barrow is doing, whether it was that big tank that they bought yesterday that will be throwing water at people or strengthening the PIU or whatever, all is geared towards restricting the democratic space in this country. And I believe that is not why we fought, and that was not the reason why people voted Jammeh out.
And also, you run the This Week in Politics from London for Hot FM, and Of course, it's been winning the hearts and minds of the Gambians, not just the quality of it, but also the content and then the kind of guests that you've been featuring. In getting your guests and collectively the answers that you've been having, you've been getting for your questions, your guests, in terms of accountability and people free flow of information speaking out, where do you see the Gambia today?
In a very poor and dismal light, because the very people who are custodians of this information, the understanding normally in a democracy is that the journalists are the intermediary between the politicians and the people. And politicians ought to see journalists as partners, basically, because they need them to be able to proffer a message. So I always like to put this analogy, like a politician sees a microphone is a moth seeing light. They're instantly attracted to it because they see it as a medium to channel whatever it is they're trying to propagate as politicians. In the Gambia, it's the other way around. So we've got it backwards. We've got the coach before the horse. And what ends up happening is that people see journalists, or politicians, shall I say, see journalists and flee the other way and think, oh my gosh, you know, I really can't possibly talk to Issa Williams because he's going to ask me the tough questions. But what do you have to hide? If there is nothing to hide, democracy, sunlight is the best disinfectant in a democracy. You put it out there. If there is a narrative that's running you believe to be false, come on the program, come on not just my program, your program, any program, and speak and let people hear an alternative point of view. Because then what ends up happening is twofold. So firstly, you get a message out there. Secondly, what happens is that people say, oh, that rumor that you're talking about, well, we heard from Minister X, Y, or Z. That's not what actually happened. This is what they said. And believe you me, they're going to be interrogated, as well they should.
Sidi Sani, two issues I particularly want to take up with you. One is the economic situation of the country. But before that, I want to look at the Gambia's position today in the outside world, Gambia's relationship with the outside world. As a former diploma, career diploma, first, the OIC missed opportunity, a lot of people would say. But then the government came celebrating because the Gambia was mandated to head the issue of the Rohingya Muslims. And this was celebrated from the government quarters as a success story. Where is the Gambia today when it comes to its respect with the outside world, at the outside world?
Well, I think the government has disappointed quite a lot of our partners, both the partners in development and also on the diplomatic front. Because when Barrow took charge in January 2007, the idea was it is going to be a transitional government. The transition has now extended beyond the 3 years. It appears that he is planning on settling for 5 years instead. This has disappointed many of our partners. The European, the Brussels donor conference raised $1.5 billion. But as a result of the fact that there has been this backsliding on the part of the government, most of those resources, if not all of it now, is not going to come, except for what France has given in the form of grants and the like. On the OIC, that again, when they said a year ago or even a year and a half ago that the OIC was going to be held in the Gambia this year, most of us said, it's not possible. It is simply not possible. What the government should have done then, rather than raise the hopes and aspiration of Gambians, was to come out and say, look, we cannot host this given what the infrastructural program that it requires. But they did not, which is very typical of the government. They always come up with a program that they know. If they have any sort of technicians, they would know that you cannot construct a four-lane highway from Yundum all the way to the conference center. It again is shooting themselves in the foot.
Is that a diplomatic defeat?
Well, I don't know whether you can call it a diplomatic defeat, but certainly on the parts of the OIC and those who are financing it, it was a big disappointment.
I'll come back to you. Jegan Gray Johnson, the issue of transparency. You've written extensively about this, the need for government to open up, especially to the citizenry. Is this government transparent?
No, they're absolutely not transparent. One of the first things that they did, and to prove the facts are there, last year, April I think it was, but last year sometime, within the second quarter of last year, the first thing that this government did was actually to dilute and diminish the effectiveness of the Gambia Public Procurement Act by basically just expunging the idea that the role that the major tender board would have played, whereby any procurement or tenders that are above a certain threshold has to basically go through the rigor of intensive competition, open competition, and the criteria is very clear. It's set out there for these things to happen. And they basically amended that to now make sure that the procurement process is actually now open to arbitrariness and discretionism. And that's been happening. We've seen what's happened with Semlex. Semlex was very clear. There was actually a National Assembly inquiry that was ongoing. And President Barrow decided just to ignore that, and basically blurring the separation lines of separation of powers, the lines of separation of powers, using executive overreach and executive power, and unilaterally giving a contract that was kept, by the way, as a secret to Semlex, knowing fully well that this was being investigated and the organization is of questionable reputation. So clearly, this government has not really moved very far from President Jammeh's opacity and the penchant that it has for secrecy, because everything that is being done under the table has now to be viewed with grave suspicion.
And in the Right to Know coalition, you sent a letter to the president to respond to the OCCRP report, investigation, corruption report, and then a letter came out saying that the president wanted you to hand over the material as evidence. Did you do that? What's the response so far? What's the latest?
Well, I think that request, one is, if it wasn't so serious, it'll be laughable, because it's in the public domain. So clearly, it tells you that either they're finding ignorance, which is completely disingenuous, by virtue of the fact that, one, also, for them to express surprise by this actually contradicts the fact that it was the Barrow administration that initially asked for this. Now, the person that was at the forefront of it is no longer in the administration, but that does not take away from the fact that it was his administration that asked for it. So, yes, they wrote we actually forwarded them the link. Mm-hmm. We haven't heard anything back. But the bottom line is that we intend to follow through on this OCAP report, because $1 billion that was pilfered by one man and aided and abetted by the same individuals that are still heavily entrenched in the Barrow administration, utilize and being paid for by taxpayers' money, utilizing Gambia government vehicles to go about their business back and forth, and still are the custodians, some of them are the custodians of donor funds that are still coming through today, is worthy of investigation, and we need to expose that.
And Dr. Cisse, at the heart of public discourse today is the issue of whether or not Barrow should serve 3 years and step down, as agreed during the formation of the coalition. A lot of people say it's a problem. It's between moral issue and anything else. If President Barrow refuses to step down at the end of a three-year term and continues, what will that mean for the country and for the leadership of the country?
I think for me this issue has become a very complex issue now. There are two sides, obviously, the debate, the legal issue and the moral issue. Legally, Barrow is not bound by law to resign. He can if he so wish to, but he cannot be forced to resign. Morally, it's a promise he made. Everybody here supported the coalition agenda and the transition based on the coalition agenda. Even the ECOWAS, the African Union, the UN, even the stabilization force they sent in to restore democracy, because partly it's because the transition agenda, the coalition agenda, was attractive. Everybody supported it. It was to inject a new democratic culture in our polity, to start afresh, to avoid, to have reconciliation, and to avoid self-perpetuating rule. It was very attractive that let's do these 3 years, do all the reforms, go for elections, start anew, constitute democracy in our system. So now, but it has come to a point whereby most of the reforms that were supposed to be done are not done. There is no precedent. If Barrow resigns, what will happen? On all these, there are so many uncertainties and unanswered questions. And for me, I think we should approach the whole issue with caution. For me, I think this thing is so serious, it should be left with politicians alone. They messed up. The politicians, when they met and they made agreements that they knew they could not fulfill. And today they are divided. Some are saying, even though they agreed when they sat on the table, we are going for 3 years. Some are saying, no, we are going for 5 years because it is not signed. I mean, the very people who sat and agreed are saying now, no, it is not signed because of their own personal interest. For me, I think now we shouldn't leave it to the politicians because they messed up.
Let me take that with Coach. This issue should be left with politicians. It's their mess and it's their responsibility to clean the mess.
I don't think it is their responsibility. I think it is our responsibility to make sure that they clean the mess. Because here is what's going to happen. Barrow has been dragging his feet together with people like Dr. Cisse clearly said, who are more interested in occupying position than adhering to promises that are made to the Gambian people. Politicians have been given this blanket description as being dishonest. And if Barrow fails to honor the promise that he has made, what he is doing is cementing that belief that people have in politicians. Nobody forced Adama Barrow to agree to a 3-year term. The agreements were 3. 1, you will resign from your party, he did. 2, you will serve for 3 years. 3, you will not run the subsequent elections. Other than resigning from his party, which he knew if he did not do, parties like Doi would have backed out of the coalition. He did that conveniently. Now, to honor the other promises, he failed. But Barrow did not fail alone. He was helped in failing. And my friend, Mr. Dabo, has a lot to answer to that. Because when Dabo came, because you see, Dabo cannot have a personal opinion. Dabo is one of the most respected people in this country. He has one of the biggest followings in this country. When he emphatically made that statement that Barrow, if anybody wanted to force Barrow to resign, he would take the person to court. He didn't say, I'm going to kill somebody. He said, I'll take the person to court. What that did was it inadvertently strengthened Barrow's hand. And of course, Dabo was the visible one. At least he was honest enough to come and tell us, you know what, this is what I believe. Ahmad Ba, on the other hand, was there, agreed to 3 years. Today he will not talk about it. He will tell you, oh, nothing was signed. It wasn't signed anywhere. To Ahmad, it's not what is in the interest of the Gambia, but how long Ahmad will continue to serve as a minister.
One more thing.
We've seen Maifati, my comrade, upon his firing, had an interview. It was published in the Standard. I was talking about, you know, this agreement was central to why we came together. It's a moral issue, and I believe that people should adhere to promises that they made. Today, if you were to ask my 3 years or 5 years, you'll be hearing a different tune because today he has a job.
And so did you see this coming, the president changing the tone and the language from 5 years to now we have projects, they're not done, we're not complete with the projects, and then the constitution says 5, and if I don't see of the 5 years, we'll have constitutional crisis. Did you see this coming?
Yeah, I saw it a mile away. I mean, and even a blind man could have seen it, because I'd been saying from the very start we'd been experiencing with the coalition government. And the best example I can think of is what they have in France called cohabitation. So you bring people of various parties and put them together and have a coalition that works. The problem with our coalition is that you had party leaders. Now, in any democracy, a party leader is a leader in waiting. They want to take the country in a different direction. That's why they're in a different party from the ruling party or the party that's got majority, I mean the majority in parliament or in government. Now, so you get party leaders, you put them in a cabinet. A cabinet in our presidential system, indeed even in a prime ministerial system, is a reflection of the direction in which the leader of the country wants to take the country. So you've got people with opposing views from you who want to take the country in a different direction. You put them in leadership positions in the cabinet that is supposed to go in a certain direction. It's a recipe for chaos. This is chaos Gambian style. I mean, even the chaotic nature doesn't even itself make sense. Sometimes chaos is born out of thought, a thought process that goes wrong. This was a disaster before it even happened. And to explain, just to answer, I know you didn't ask me this question, but about the trust that people have in politicians and politics. This is a very, very important point, because when politics fails, you have Rwanda. This is not a joke. And if people lose faith in politics and you say one thing and do another in office, then you're going to hear the siren voices of trouble and mischief and tribalism and division come to the fore, because at that point politics has lost it. And this government still has time. It's on the precipice. It's about 5 minutes to midnight. It's not quite midnight yet.
And then, Sidi, I'm going to change the question a bit to economy. When this government came to power, first, every question asked is that we inherited a bankrupt country. Jammeh took everything. But that stopped now because there's a lot of international goodwill. We know money's been coming in, pledges and all those things. Now, even recently, I think a few days ago, the finance minister was speaking, you know, talking about the economy and the gains, you know, the government picking up the pieces. And now we are on the right track, according to the authorities, including the finance minister. Is the country on the right track when it comes to reviving the economy?
I don't think so. But before I even proceed with that, let me just say that, let me acknowledge the fact that at least the growth rate is 6%. Which they've touted all over the place, which is fine, because it's better certainly than 4% or 3%. But 6% with an inflation that has gone up now by another percentage point within the same period is now 7%. And if you look at the unemployment rate of young people, I mean, this is a recipe for disaster, okay? 6% growth rate is nothing to write home about. Again, I'm going to say to them, well, kudos, you've made 6% rate. You're going to maintain it, at least to maintain that trajectory to a higher rate. But there are so many other underlying economic problems. One, the domestic debt is still on the rise. Inflation is on the rise. Unemployment is going up. I mean, really, I think the apart from that, also you have the budgetary deficit, domestic debt. These are all issues which need to be addressed. We are spending more with less. And I thought that there should have been an austerity program put into place long time ago. We've been saying that. And the restructuring of the civil service was part and parcel of that. You cannot do things piecemeal. You have to look at the whole economy in a very comprehensive manner. But the restructuring of the civil service, they've dragged their feet. Even with the security sector reform.
Is that likely to put off our donors, international donors?
They already have. I can say that now. They already have, because they are very disappointed with the rate at which that we are putting in place those reforms that we promised them. Even in Brussels a year ago, they have not been really putting up to the expectations of our partners bilaterally and multilaterally as well.
And then, this will be my last round, and I'll ask everyone to be as brief as possible. You wrote about the issue of the former president's men, now this new president's men, the same people we've seen in some cases, the issue of an old wine, you know, in a new bottle. In terms of directing the president, because we've seen some of the sensitive departments, ministries, in the hands of, you know, people who, I must say and I must stress, that they've not been found guilty of anything yet by anybody, but then who people accuse of misleading and, you know, aiding and abetting during the former regime, the former president. How much impact or how much damage do you think this has caused to the new government and the way it you know, it operates?
The damage is so deep and is so wide that I think it may actually be irredeemable. They're not going to be able to come back from that for two reasons. One is they should have nipped it in the bud as part of the reforms and as part of demonstrating a new leaf and also a new leadership in setting the tone from the very beginning. They didn't do that. Now, these guys are firmly entrenched once again, because they've grown confident. They feel that, you know, because of the blank, they're shrouded in the blanket of impunity and nothing can really touch them. That's the first thing. Secondly, by virtue of the fact that this new administration has decided to cozy up to even suspects, because if you are entrusted with public office, perception is important. So even if there's a semblance of doubt over your integrity, step aside, clear your name, and then come back in. This wasn't even the case. This was blatant. Individuals went to the Jana Commission and said, I took money, I facilitated the theft of the state. I facilitated the raiding of the central bank. And that's what it was. They were bank robbers. So as a result, what has happened now is they are so firmly entrenched that the collusion between Jame and these culprits has now transcended and moved between these culprits and Baro. So in order to disentangle himself from it, he cannot, because the mess now is so complicated and the waters are so muddied that I'm afraid the only way, and I know this sounds drastic, the only way of basically being able to free ourselves from the grip of endemic corruption, which was a legacy of Jame and is now being actually perpetuated and continued by Baro, is to basically have a clean sweep. And that has to start at the top.
Dr. Cisse, do you believe that the damage is so huge that we might not be able to fix it again?
Like Soha said, it's 5 minutes to midnight. And obviously, there has been a lot of damage. And to be honest, to this government as well, to be very frank, most of the damage is not caused by this government. But the problem with this government is they did not find the solutions to solve this damage. And it's getting worse. We have problems in this country. Like my brother here, Coach, has said, every sector is collapsing. It's on the verge of collapsing. We're heading towards a catastrophe, environmental, economic, demographic, you name it. But what this government has failed to do really is to come up with solutions, like practical solutions to say, look, these are the problems. This is why the health sector is failing. This is why the education sector is failing. This is why we have this. And then what are the solutions? How do we prepare for the looming demographic crisis? We have a young population. A population today is 1.8 million. And within a generation, it will be 4 million. Are we preparing for that? Housing, infrastructure, education, health. Are we preparing for that? And for me, that is what scares me. It's not today. For me, when I think of how will the Gambia be in 2045, that is what I think about. And I think that is where we should start now to think of how do we build the Gambia for the future. Because the previous generation failed. They failed to build a country. And today we have this mess. Now, we don't want to fail the next generation.
And then, Coach, in December 2016, it happened. It was possible when nobody thought Jame could have been, you know, ousted through the ballot box. Gambia, there was a lot of difference when it comes to our ideologies, individual differences, religious, tribal, whatever, you know. But then everybody came together, at least overwhelming majority of Gambians left behind everything just to make sure that change happened, the change that they yearned for. And Baro came, there was a lot of euphoria, jubilation, hope, everything. But then the tunes are different today. In your opinion, where do you think the government went wrong? At what stage do you think the government got off the cliff?
Well, they went wrong when they betrayed the aspirations of the people. And when they started going off the cliff was when everybody was interested in occupying ministerial positions rather than ensuring that the agenda of the coalition was adhered to. Because they had an agreement and they started breaking the agreement before even sitting in cabinet. And that's where everything went wrong. Everybody wanted to be the head chief. And before you know it, all hell broke loose. And the people that are paying the brunt of the price are the average Gambians.
And do you see any possibility or easy possibility of this problem getting fixed? Is it fixable?
It is fixable, but not by our current situation, because I don't think Baro has demonstrated any desire to fix it, because Baro is fixated on fixing his problem, which is entrenching himself in power. He has, as they say, he has a 15-year plan or agenda, so that's what he's working on. So that's the problem. And he doesn't have the capacity to do it.
Esuhal, I wouldn't name the name, but then a foreign friend who met Baro and sat with him and, you know, discussed with him. At the end of the meeting, when he came out, he told me, he looked me in the face and said, unfortunately, you guys are going to have a blank term and fix things and make things happen after this, when the next one comes. How discouraging, how hopeless are you when it comes to especially service delivery during this regime?
So, I mean, I don't even have the adjectives to describe it. But the only thing I can think of, and it's sad, is the fact that, you know, you fix the roof when the sun is shining, not when there's a deluge of rain coming down. And Barrow, I mean, for all intents and purposes, I don't think I'm breaking any journalistic rule because I do have a view as a Cambian and as a person. It was a total disaster from the start. I mean, the man didn't have the capacity to absorb information to begin with, which is the first rule you need in politics. First, you retain the information, you analyze it, you come up with possible solutions. Secondly, he couldn't surround himself with people with that same capacity and ability to deliver. So service delivery is always a step behind. And then what ends up happening is that the Gambia is constantly, if you notice, they put out a policy, then they retract it. It's done with a lot of bombast and noise. I mean, they talked about the think tank. What's the think tank and when is it? I mean, I think the thinking has tanked, if you ask me, because no one is doing any thinking clearly in the government. It's completely dissipated. It's disappeared. It's gone into the night. And this government has no clue about what to do. They're making up policy as they go on. It's obvious to anybody watching. And it's not, if you don't even have to be, you know, clued in to see what's happening. That's a total disaster. And as Coach said, the poor price is being paid by the poor Gambian who's not going to see any changes, who's going to see their hopes dashed yet again, whose son or daughter, but mostly their son, is going to go on the back way. I'm sorry, I'm about to take a plane on Saturday out of this country. If you told me that aircraft had a 50% chance of making it across the Atlantic, I'm not going to board it. This guy's got a 50% chance of making it to Lampedusa, having gone through Agadez to Tripoli. Yeah, and they may not make it across the Mediterranean. These are our brothers who are dying there because of a failed government back at home that's pushing them into death.
And Sidi, let's assume Barrow, it looks like that Barrow is going to see of the 5-year term until 2021. If that happens, you mirror the future of this country from now to 2021. What do you see?
Well, I see a very bleak future. Even if Barrow leaves 3 years, because a good part of the damage has already been inflicted on the economy, on the psyche of the people, and just about every sector of the economy is going to suffer. Now, for 5 years, it's just going to get worse. And it will take us, I was saying before, that maybe perhaps with the damage already done by Ajame 22 years, it's going to take us a generation or two. You can add another half a generation or more if he stays beyond 3 years.
And that's it for the Open Forum on the Chronicle. My name is Sherif Wojang Jr. My guest, Jagan Gray Johnson, Dr. Ismail Asise, Coach Pason Bajau, Esso Williams, and Sidi Sane. Thank you very much.
Thank you.